Stand up, high five two or three people, and tell them how good it is to see them in the house of the Lord. If you don't believe it and mean it, don't say it, I guess. Just high five them. All right. If I can get everybody's attention real quick, I have some announcements I need to make. Number one. This Friday night is a youth prayer meeting, as well as there is a cookout, like a hot dog and s'mores and stuff around the fire here at the church fellowship, couples fellowship. And so please be a part of that. And I get that right? Hot dogs, s'mores, no? Favorite meat. Don't bring hot dogs then. Nobody likes favorite meat of hot dogs. Just bring s'mores. But we are having a time of fun and fellowship, and we're going to be enjoying that together. So please be a part of that. All the young people are going to be here, and they're going to be up here in church praying, and we will be down there having fun. We'll be playing. They'll be praying. Good deal right there. And so make sure you come back and be a part of that. Next thing is this next Sunday, this coming Sunday, is Friendship Sunday. So please bring stuff for you to eat. In other words, bring a meat, a side, and a dessert. We're going to have a good time together. If you cannot afford to bring a meat, side, and dessert, come anyway, okay? Because everybody tries to cook a little bit more so that they can make sure they cover for their friends. Because it is Friendship Sunday after all. So this Sunday is Friendship Sunday. We're going to bring a meat, side, and dessert, all right? Everybody, meat, side, and dessert. And then a couple things this Friday night, all right? Is there, I think that's that brings me to the next point. If you're going to do a booth, all right, not a booth, that's a bad word. If you're going to have a table at our trunk or treat down there, please make sure you come Sunday ready to decorate for that. That'll save you the opportunity because we don't have church Sunday night. We have Friendship Sundays at 11 for all of you newer people. We have Friendship Sunday at 11. So make sure you come ready to have church at 11, not 10. And then also afterwards, we don't have church that night. It's an all-day cook and fun on the grounds at the FLC and just hanging out and having a good time. And then that night, we'll set up in the gymnasium because we have our trunk or treat that's going to be the very next night, which is Monday night. So Sunday night, we set up in the gym. Monday night, we're going to have trunk or treat, all right? So we're going to have a good time down there. And we want all the leaders to be involved again this year. But even if you're not a leader, even if you've not done any leadership in the last year, we would love for you to be involved. If you want to put a booth up, decorate it. If you want to just put a booth up with a tablecloth over it and give out candy, that's fine too. We just love having everybody get involved. And the last few years, this has really been a good thing for us. And it's been big. And 2013 on, it's been just really great. And I feel like that if we do this the right way, we can really win souls for it. And it also has given us a good name in the community, if nothing else. We're on all kinds of Facebook sites, and our name is just getting out there because of that. So make sure you're here and a part of that. And it's a good, safe environment. Please remember, we're still Holy Ghost-filled people. Please remember that. So don't decorate like with demonic things or nothing like that. We're not into the demons except rebuking them. Amen. Hallelujah. And you never know. If I see a demonic thing on your table, I might come over and start praying for it. And next thing you know, your table will collapse and your candy will be everywhere. So that's a joke. But we're going to have a good time. So everybody, you may be seated. We're going to start this service off the way we do every year, just having a fun time with these kids. It's a lot of fun for the kids, even if you don't enjoy it. Please make sure you act like you enjoy it. Then we're going to go into praise and worship. We're going to pray, and we're going to have a good time tonight just enjoying Jesus together. So we're going to ask our kids to come in at this time, all of our young people, all of our kids come in at this time. And what we do, for all of you that maybe have never done this before, is we guess what Bible characters these kids are. I know it's a little unique, but it's our way to kind of enjoy Halloween and get your kids hyper. So we're excited about all these kids dressing up, and they get to have a good time with it every year. And believe it or not, I was even in Halloween once. Amen. Praise God. So crazy. So, all right. So since we have nobody in the front that's an adult, we'll just assume you guys are going first. So if you're coming together or one at a time, just come on, whichever you're going to do. Dude, you're making me nervous with that spoon in your mouth. Take it out when you climb. All right, thank you. All right, turn hey, right here. Nope, you don't get to take the stage. All right, y'all are together. All right, we're going to guess very quickly tonight. Ethan. The three Hebrew boys. No. Three wise men, no. Huh? Jacob and Esau. There's three people up here. I don't want to point out the obvious. Trevor. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. No, I think I know who you are, but I don't want to tell anybody because they all need to guess. See how many knows their Bible. He has a bow, an arrow. He has a pot and a spoon. And this guy's really old. Sister Krasinski. That's right, probably. Esau, Jacob, and Isaac. I thought so. Good job, guys. Everybody give him a round of applause. Don't step on his bathrobe. All right. Next. Come on, girl. Nice. Are you Rindy? You are? All right, you're done. No, I'm just joking. All right, anybody guess? I'm not going to tell you who she's got. She's got Rudolph in a pot. Just telling you that straight up. She's the Grinch's cook. All right. I have hands all over the place. We'll go with Marisa first. Rebecca. All right. Good job. I feel like there's a whole plot going on over there. Come on. Look at this guy, man. Turn the face. All right. Can we turn this guy right side up like this? There you go. Big guess here. Jackson. Daniel. Are you Daniel? Good job, buddy. Daniel and the lion. Very cool. He could have been Samson. All right. Come on. Are you guys... you're by yourself? Come on, Chiquita. Woo! Guess. Ethan. Are you Lydia?
Yes.
All right. Good job, Lydia. Dude, that is pretty powerful right there. Honey and Nasty Bugs. Hey, after you're done with this, on the way down that aisle back there, you know who my wife is, Michelle? All right, show her those bugs. She'll want to see them. All right, Savannah. Are you Samson? He's not Samson. Ethan. John the Baptist. Good job, John the Baptist. All right. Come on, baby. Yep. You're Jeremy Warfield's daughter. You had to come up a different way. Come on. You want me to help you? Come on, baby girl. You got this. Oh, yeah. You look so cute. Look at this. Everybody look. Whoop, whoop. Come on now, that's good stuff. Shane, are you a wolf in sheep's clothing? Nope. I think I know what she is. Are you the lion and the lamb? Which is Jesus. Yeah, good job. You're so cute. A lion and a lamb. However, the lamb's leg on this side sort of looks like a cheetah. Very cute. Thank you. All right, come on. Man, you're stepping on him, dude. Oh, wow. We have a bowl with this. Are you ready to turn that around? Are you? Oh, you're not going to do it. You're going to keep it. Ha ha. Who do you think these guys are? Jacob and Esau. Turn around, let everybody see it. Boom. Birthright, Esau. Good job, guys. Jacob and Esau? Are you Jacob and Esau?
Nope.
He's not. What's your name?
Johnny.
I love it when they do that. Johnny. I'm not Jacob Nesau. I'm Johnny. You'd think you'd know that by now, Pastor VanLue. All right. Turn and look at everybody and smile. Now, if you say serenity, I'm done. All right. All right. Do you know? All right. Ethan? Esther?
No.
No. Jackson?
No.
No. Marisa? Queen of Sheba?
No.
No. No. Say it like David Shatwell. Sister Krasinski? I was already guessed. Trevor? Pharaoh's daughter?
No.
No. Want to give a hint?
I once was a queen.
Sister Lewis? Vashti?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Come on. Come on. Somebody, come on. Are you ready? All right. Ethan.
Yes.
Yes. Good job. All right. Come on, guys. Dude, that's bad the bone right there. Come on, somebody. I bet you won't get it. Jackson? Well, that's what he did. Who is he? Moses. Go back to Bible class. Sister Lewis. Jesus. Yeah, turn water into wine. Good job. All right. All right. Guessing? Ethan. Melchizedek. No. Give us a hint? No hint? All right. Carrie. Zacchaeus. No. Do you have a hint? You do have a hint? All right. Huh? He has a hint, but he wants to tell you who it is. No, I'll give you a hint. He baptized people. No, no, that what? No, yeah, we already had him, he said. He baptized somebody in Acts 8. Yeah, Philip it is. Good job. All right, Schaefer, you coming or no? No. Come here, Schaefer. Run up here. All right, never mind. Not going to work. Let's give all of our kids a round of applause. Everybody. All right. I heard you guys are going to have some fun down in the FLC, so you guys can go follow Brother Justin down there right now. And wave bye at everybody. Don't forget to show Sister Michelle your bug. Whatever you do. Yeah, especially with it being in your mouth. She'll love that. Amen. These kids are cute, ain't they? Everybody did such a great job. Let's give them all one more round of applause as they leave. Amen. We're getting ready to go to God in prayer and ask God to touch us all and help us. Sister Barbara McCoy's in need of healing tonight. And we're going to ask God to heal her body. And then Sister Taryn Blueball is in need of healing, has pneumonia possibly. So let's remember her in prayer tonight. Brother Tyler Freeman is in need of healing. He's very sick in his body. What I'm getting ready to ask you, I'm getting ready to preface it. I'm asking everybody to not put anything on Facebook. Don't comment on Facebook. Don't say things on Facebook. But my father-in-law, they've taken him to the ER. Possibly with a heart attack. And so let's pray for him tonight as we go to prayer, that God would help him. My wife's pretty tore up over it and living far enough away. Pray that it's something else. They've been giving him nitro all night. So just pray that it's something else and not a heart attack. But please, you know, just keep it off social media. There's reasons why we don't want everybody knowing, but I told Sister Michelle before church, I said, well, we're definitely going to have the church pray because we need God to intervene. So Brother Tyler, Brother Dunnigan, Taryn Blueball, Sister Barbara McCoy. Is there any other requests that needs to be made? Sister Blueball. Amen. Let's pray for Sister Janet Blueball. Let's pray for Katrina. Pray for Bruce. He's not here tonight because he's very sick. Brother Krasinski. What's his name? All right, let's pray for John. Will you stand? Yes, ma'am. Amen. Let's pray for Sister Bert. Amen. All right, let's go before God right now. Jesus, we love you and we thank you for your word and your glory, your power to heal. You're always the healer. Manifest your glory. Show yourself mighty in this place, Father. Manifest your love to us tonight, God. Have your way amongst your people right now. Take control of this service. Manifest your glory to every single request. Sister Bert tonight. God, pray for John, Brother Chuck's manager, Lord. God, we pray for Sister Janet Blueball, and we pray for Katrina tonight. We ask that you would heal and that you would make a way. We pray for Bruce tonight, that he would be healed. Sister Barbara McCoy tonight, God, heal her body. Take control of the issues that are going on in that situation. I pray right now that you would touch Sister Taryn, God, and that you would heal her, that you would take control of that right now in the name of Jesus. I pray that you would touch Brother Dunnigan tonight, that you would heal his body, whatever it might be, God, whatever the issue is. Lord, we pray that you would continue the work, God, that you have already started. I believe you're the healer. I'm asking you to touch each and every request tonight, Lord. Continue to heal Sister Jenny Morrell. Touch Brother Garland tonight. Touch Brother Kelvin. Let a special virtue go out of these walls, God, and heal those that have been able, Lord, not to even be in the house of God for a while. I pray right now that you would make a way where there is no way and that you would show yourself mighty. In Jesus' name we pray and we thank you for it. In Jesus' name, somebody say amen. Amen. Let's worship with the praise team as they come. Amen. And lead us into the throne of grace.
Sing. There's a song in my heart, I can hear it ring. So I look to the heavens with my hands raised high. I look to you, and as one we rise. Praise your name, I praise your name. You are to me my everything. Without your love, your saving grace, since I met you, my life has changed. Hallelujah. Oh, there's a song in my heart.
That I have to sing.
There's a song in my heart.
I can hear it ring. So I look to the heavens
with my hands raised high. I look to you and as one we rise. Oh, I lift you up. I praise your name. You are to me my everything. Without your love, your saving grace, since I met you, my life has. I lift you up. I praise your name. You are to me my everything. Without your love, your saving grace, since I met you, my life has. I lift you up, I praise your name. You are to me my everything. Without your love, your saving grace, since I met you, my life has changed. Oh, Hallelujah. 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 Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Hey. Hallelujah. We worship you, God. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, my life has. I lift you up. I praise your name. You are to me my everything. Without your love, your saving grace, since I met you, my life has changed.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, yeah, the Messiah. Hallelujah. Are you thankful tonight that you met the Lord? And that he didn't leave you the same way as you when you walked in. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I'm so thankful tonight. Thankful tonight for the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. We're getting ready to take up this evening's offering. Before we do, we're going to invoke the spirit of Goshen. Hallelujah, hallelujah. So if you look at somebody, link up with somebody, maybe somebody that you haven't linked up with yet, somebody new, if you have to step across the aisle and look them in the eye and tell them with all authority in the name of Jesus, you're going to get a raise on your job. A bonus check or an unexpected blessing. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Look them in the eye and begin to tell them, may the blessings of the Lord be upon you. I bless you in the name of the Lord. Now, if everybody across this room will begin to raise your hands and pray to the Lord. God, we invoke the spirit of Goshen. God, we bind what the enemy God has. Hallelujah, God, it's all of yours. God, and we claim it in the name of Jesus. We claim it, God, in your name. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you for it, God. Thank you for it, God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you for it, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If the ushers will come receive the evening offering, you may be seated. Worship with us as we sing.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. Oh, you give life.
Pour out our praise.
your bread out of our lungs,
so we pour out our praise to you only.
Hallelujah. Oh, we worship you, God. You give life. Oh, you give life. You are
love. You bring light
to the darkness.
You give hope.
You give hope.
You restore
every heart.
Every heart
that is broken and gray. You're so great. Will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord, and all the earth will shout.
Our
hearts will cry,
these bones
will sing. And all the earth will shout
your praise.
Oh, our hearts
will cry, these bones will sing.
Great are you, Lord. And
all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing.
They'll sing great. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, we worship you, God. Hey, and all the earth will shout your praise.
Our hearts will cry,
these bones will sing. Great, great are you, Lord. Oh, great are you, Lord. All the earth.
Shout.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. He's the reason we're here tonight. He's the reason why I live and I breathe and that I move. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Can we love him all across this room one more time? Hallelujah, as we turn this service to our pastor.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus' name. What a good guy. I thought the Lord spoke. Hallelujah. Sometimes he speaks with a thunder. Amen. Hallelujah. Who am I that you are mindful of me, that you hear me when I call? And is it true that you are thinking of me? How you love me. It's amazing. I want to try my best to preach to you tonight for very small few minutes. And I don't say that lightly, because here in a second we're all going to repent and we're going to take communion. And if you're not ready for that, I'm sorry. If you want to pass it by, it can just walk. Nobody will even know. It'll go right past you if you don't agree with it or you don't want to take it. But we're going to do that to close out this month. Amen. I want to turn your attention to the book of Philippians, chapter 3, verse number 10. Amen. Hallelujah. Philippians 3 and 10. Amen. I want to draw your attention. We always go to the power of his resurrection, fellowship of his sufferings, and all that being made foremost. I want to draw your attention to that first few words here. And that's that I may know him. That I may know him. And the power of his resurrection. And the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable to his death. If by any means that I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Three things. One, I got to know him. Two, I got to know the power. Three, I got to be able to fellowship or be one with or have part in his sufferings. If I might attain the resurrection of the dead. God is putting us in a position as a church that I feel like it's time to lack of a better colloquialism, put up or shut up. Be it or don't even talk about it. I feel like the Lord told me in prayer tonight that we have medicated our lack of power. And we have to get back to the root of this thing. Brother LaFoon, I almost had him sing tonight. We need to get back to the basics of life. Not just because it's fresh in my mind from the hog roast, but because it is the reality of where I feel like this church has got to go as your pastor and your watchman. We have got to come back to the basics of what this whole thing is about. Jesus, I'm asking you to help me speak, Lord. Nobody knows like I know, God, how much I need you every day. Your way We are nothing without you. We can do nothing without you. Speak to us tonight, God. In Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. I read this today and it really ripped me up because of what it represents to us in the winter. But many trees appear to be healthy when we see them in the summer. But in the winter, after their leaves fall off, we sometimes find that hidden underneath the lush green of the summer foliage was a parasitic plant called mistletoe, which had been slowly sucking away some of the tree's vitality. We as Christians sometimes have hidden sins, which, like the mistletoe, slowly suck away at our spiritual vitality. I'm just reading what this says. Although not always evident in times of outward spiritual health and fruitfulness, we must always examine ourselves for those small, often unseen parasites of sinful habits that will sap our spiritual man and woman. And we must also remember that just because they are not apparent now does not mean that in another season of our life, God will not reveal them for all to see. It was the great missionary David Brainerd who spent his belief and his brief life, because he died before he was 30 years old, ministering to American Indians. And he wrote in his journal these words, "I never got away from Jesus Christ and Him crucified. When my people I pastored were gripped by this great evangelical doctrine of Christ and Him crucified, I had no need to give them instructions about morality, about holiness. I found that one followed as the sure and inevitable fruit of the other. If they would just get wrapped up in Jesus Christ and Him crucified, they would be everything He needed them to be." He also said, "This is another place. I find my Indians begin to put on the garments of holiness and their common life begins to be sanctified in small matters when they are possessed by the doctrine of Christ and Him crucified." What Brainerd was basically saying was this: when a Christian realizes who Christ is and what Christ has done for them, he so graciously as ever before always puts on a holy life and wants to know Him more than he's ever known Him before. In other words, Christ and the crucifixion of Christ is not just about salvation. It is about always living for Jesus every day that we live. Well, you might as well buckle down the hatches tonight. In fact, it was John in his epistle, or if not his epistle, in his first letter or second letter to the church, I think chapter 2, he actually says this. He said, "To be able to live for Christ is to live without sin." Now, we as Christians, most of the time, don't try to live without sin. We just try to live without a lot of sin. But John said, "I'm going to take it one step further. And that is, if you really want to know God, you're going to have to get to the place where sin is something you abhor and something you hate. In fact, if you're going to be a church set on the hill, you're going to have to hate the garment that is even spotted by the flesh." Man, my leg's feeling good right now. I wish somebody in this house would hear your pastor. It's been a day like we've never seen before. Everything is stacked against, especially the American church, but church in general. A preacher put this on right before, and it was on a news bulletin. It was right before I came out here. Amen. Actually, right before I went to prayer, and it said this. Amen. The White House Defense Department has decided that it is unconstitutional, that the Constitution is feminist, and that the Bible is feminist. And so, therefore, it should not be propagated by anybody in the United States military ever again, because it is a feminist book. But they won't embrace the Quran. It gets quiet every time you deal with real matters.
You know what? I've made up in my mind that as a church as a whole, maybe not necessarily you as a person, but the church as a whole, you all don't want preachers. You want to heap to yourself teachers having itching ears. Because when you deal with real life issues, this church goes graveyard dead. But it's the facts. Well, man, they won't mess with the Quran, but the Christians are getting ready to find out that they're going to be persecuted all over this nation. Unless somebody makes up in their mind that as for me and my house, we will not buckle, we will not go cower under a bush, we will not mess around, we're going to get on our knees and we're going to pray like we've never prayed before. Protesting might not work, but prayer is going to work. Saying stuff on Facebook might not work, but prayer is going to work. All right, I'm going to get on topic because I see some of y'all are sitting on me. So here's the deal. The Lord dealt with me in the last few days about knowing Him. Knowing Him like we've never known Him before. And not just medicating the points where we don't know Him. We had somebody come here the other day that needed deliverance, Bishop. They needed deliverance. Very, very, very bad. Very bad. And people was scared. One girl walked up to this girl and said, "Hello, praise the Lord, how are you? It's good to see you, good to have you tonight." And she kind of snarled at this girl and growled at her. And she needed deliverance. But we were scared. People were scared. Sitting in this room, were scared of what was going to happen. And I got this mindset, this flash of the statement where the seven sons of Sceva goes in to pray a devil out of somebody. And they say, "We adjourn you by Jesus whom Paul preaches." We adjourn you by Jesus whom Paul preaches. They had no personal relationship with Jesus Christ. They had a relationship with Paul. But they had no relationship with Jesus Christ. And I ask myself, as your pastor, if I was not around and a devil recognized the Holy Ghost in you in the middle of some place and started snarling at you and grabbing at your clothes, would you have the knowledge of the Spirit to know what to do, what to say? "Well, I'd just scream the name of Jesus." No, listen to me. Listen to me. Listen to me. "We adjourn you by Jesus." They said the name. The name is not going to be powerful unless you have a relationship with that name. It's quiet in this house tonight. "We adjourn you by Jesus whom Paul preaches about. We adjourn you by Jesus who Jeremy talks about all the time to leave me alone." And the devil says, "Now look, I know Jesus and I know Paul." I wish Brother Shatwell was here right now. "But who are you? Who are you? I know Jesus. I know Paul. But I don't know who you are, Big Daddy, because you're some yokel local that don't have the time to have a relationship with Jesus Christ. Jesus, I know. And Paul, I know. But I don't know you because you never tap into the spirit realm." Well, glory to the Lord Jesus Christ. We've got to make up in our mind. We're not just churchgoers. We're God knowers. We're not just coming to the house of God. We're the people of God. We're not just people that are going to show up whenever there's a get together. We are the church of the living God. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against the church. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. Go with me to Hebrews chapter 8. I won't hold you much longer. Hebrews chapter 8. Amen. Let's go to verse 8. Hallelujah. Hebrews 8 and 8. Amen. Finding fault with them. He's talking about the Jews. Let's go back to verse 7, my brother. Amen. Verse 7. Amen. "For if that first covenant had been faultless, then should no place have been sought for the second." The second covenant. Somebody say, when God makes a covenant, it cannot be broken. for the first covenant, if it had been faultless, there should have been no place have been sought for the second covenant. But God said there's something wrong with this covenant. So he goes in verse 8. He says, for finding fault with them, he saith, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, when I will make a new covenant, and the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, because they continued not in my covenant, and I regarded them not, saith the Lord. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws into their mind, and I'll write them into their hearts. And I will be to them a God, and they shall be to me a people. Now, verse 11 is what blew my mind today. And it's a statement that is directly quoted from the prophet Jeremiah. And he says this, and they shall not teach every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know the Lord. Come on, I want to show you God. Shall know me from the least to the greatest. Ready? Verse 12 is what I really like. For I will be merciful to their unrighteousness, and their sins and their iniquities will I remember no more. I love that. If you don't love that, you ain't got any Holy Ghost in you. He said, I'm going to make sure that I forgive their unrighteousness, and I'm going to not remember their iniquity, and I'm going to cast in the sea of forgetfulness every bit of it. I'll be merciful to it. I'm not going to remember it anymore. I'm going to make sure they are free from the sin and the shame of that sin. I will be merciful to them. And in that he saith, a new covenant he hath made, the first old. Know thou that is which decayed and waxeth old is vanished away. We have a new covenant with Jesus Christ. And that is that we can have our unrighteousness turned to righteousness, and we can have all of our junk and our iniquities written away and cast into the sea of forgetfulness. Thankful for that. But what really blows my mind, Bishop, is he said, when this new covenant comes. Somebody say, we're in the new covenant. When this new covenant comes, you're not going to have to teach people to know God. Jeremiah said the same thing. He said, they shall say, teach no more every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least even to the greatest of them, saith the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquity. This is Jeremiah. Paul's quoting Jeremiah, or whoever you believe wrote Hebrews is saying to same thing Jeremiah said. He said, now we're in this covenant. And if you go into verse 9, he starts talking about the boldness of the priest and the throne of grace and how it goes before the throne of grace with the boldness and the blood and the mercy seat. And I'm grateful for all that. But he says, you're not going to have to teach people to know God. Do we know him? Do we really know God? Can you say that you know him? I gotta quit. This is what's really agging me on as a pastor. Can you really say you know Jesus Christ? You not know of him, not know about him because your pastor teaches you him, but you know him. Faking the Holy Ghost, that they're not in the Holy Ghost because the Spirit beareth witness. Can you try them that are apostles that say they're apostles and they are not, and know that they're not because they are not of God? I guess what bothers me is that if a false prophet walks in here and does a few little jumping jacks and charismatic tricks, will half of you walk out of here following another doctrine that giveth heed to fables and divine? Godliness is not in it, and you're sitting there saying, well, I know Jesus Christ. Let me tell you something. To know him is to know his voice. For he said, my sheep will know my voice, and another they will not follow. I'm want to tell you what bothers me right now is if we're in the end time, there will be many people come up that can do miracles, signs, and wonders, and they will deceive the very elect. If we're not careful, we better know Jesus. We better know him. How do you know him? It's very simple. You're going to have to get to talking to him again. I'm going to ask you a simple question. What keeps you from the prayer room? Not the prayer room downstairs, your personal prayer room. What keeps you from it? What is the excuse you give to God why you don't want to talk to him? I used to have a long-distance relationship with my wife. So I know this probably a little bit better than most people that have short distance relationships. But that is very simple. It's this. If you don't talk to them, you don't know them. And we're in a long distance relationship with Jesus Christ. I mean, he might be hanging out with some of y'all in your house. But the only thing I get is the talking to the Lord and the Spirit. I don't get a bodily form of Jesus. So we're in a long distance relationship with the groom. And the question is, do you really know him? I'm just going to tell you what God said to me in prayer. He said, we have medicated our lack of God. We have medicated it by doing everything else but talking to him. Have you ever had somebody avoid you? Anybody ever had somebody avoid you? Like you come to church, you really want to see them, you really want to talk to them, and they're like, they won't look you in the eyes. They walk around. They go the opposite way. They don't want to make eye contact with you because they're avoiding you. And the real reason is because there's something between you and them. There's no other reason. So I'm going to tell you what keeps us out of the prayer room. You have aught against God. That's quiet as a church mouse. No, I'm just busy. No, listen to me. There is nobody, I don't care what you do, that busy. Oh, help me, Holy Ghost. I said there's nobody that busy. I don't care if you work 20 hours a day. You're not so busy. We're on the way to work and on the way from work. You can't just say, hey, Jesus, I need to talk to you for a second. Now, listen, God, you're going to have to give me a little bit of leeway here. Don't be pouring a bunch of Holy Ghost in this truck because I'm going to look like a maniac for the people beside me at the stoplight. So you're going to have to just talk to me, just man to man here, just God to man. Just let's just speak back and forth. I'll say something, you say something. But if you pour the Holy Ghost in here... They're going to look at me like I'm a loony bin because I'm going to start going crazy up in this joint right now. See, some of y'all are like, I don't know what he's talking about. Hallelujah. Anybody ever had to pull over? I want everybody that had to pull over just to say amen. Amen. All right, so you know that I'm not the only crazy bird in this place because some of y'all think that I harp on prayer because I'm trying to get at everybody. But I'm going to tell you, everybody doesn't push him aside. I'm already in dangerous water, so I'm just going to shoot straight from the hip, just straight from the hip. If I'm your spiritual doctor, then some of y'all are needing some major medical treatment. Major. And so tonight, this is what we're going to do. The Bible says he's just to forgive us our sins. He's just. Now, judges are just, but they're not fair. You're not being fair. God's not supposed to be fair. He's supposed to be just. And he's just to forgive us our sins. So here's the deal. He is able and he's just to forgive us. But the just is the judge. Fair is your buddy. He's your brother. But you're going to have to let God come up here with a gavel.
and say, I'm willing to pardon your sin if you're willing to admit it. And then you got to say, God, I want to know you. Now, everybody doesn't want to know him. Now, I know I've taken way too much time. 20 minutes is too much time. But everybody does not want to know him in this room. Because when you know him, he starts telling you things. And usually it's about your mess. He tells you how to get it cleaned up. The other day, I woke up, and the first thing he said to me, I popped my feet off the bed, and I'm getting ready to get out of bed. And he said, you can either let go of it or let go of me. That's the first thing he said. I just let go of it. I don't need it. I know, it's too transparent. We like it. You can either let go of it or let go of me. You don't have to have that. You don't have to have that. I could have sat there and say, but God, it's not sin, because God, I know this, and I could have, but I didn't. I just said, yes, sir, I don't want it. I don't even want it now. If it means that I can't have you, I don't want it. Bishop preached a message one time that my father-in-law still talks about to this day, and it is, don't be silent to me, God, lest I be like those that go down to the pit. And that's been my prayer the last few days. I cannot go to heaven unless he's speaking to me. Now, I know some of you can, but I can't. And what's scaring the fire out of me is that we were in a nation that governed our spiritual liberties, but we're getting ready to see a new nation. Like I said, quiet when we go against this stuff. We're going to see a new nation coming. We're going to see a new deal here. And the question I have for you is, if you won't pray in a green season, what are you going to do when winter hits? Those mistletoes are sucking you dry right now. What are you going to do when there is no foliage and there is no fruit and there is no perfection and you can't always come to church? Kimberly Rowe went on a missions trip one time and she said, we were in there having church and they said, the people are coming. The government is coming. They're coming right now. And she said, they took all of us young people out the back door while the government was coming in the front door. And she said, we ran to the van and got in it and drove as fast as we could away. What are you going to do if that's the issue in this nation? Hey, everybody, please come to church. Please come to church. Please come to church. Well, I can't come to church because my dog is sick. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And I have a big hangnail on my big left toe, and I can't come to church. And God's saying, lovest thou me more than these? And you can blame everybody and you can say it's everybody else's fault, but when it comes down to it, you either love him or you don't love him. And when you stand in the when you stand at the judgment seat of Christ, and he says, I know you did all them good things. I know you cast out devils in my name and healed the sick in my name. And I know you went to church and you prayed in my name, but I don't know you. I don't know you. Wow. Some of us have never cast out a devil. But that's not the equivalent to being known of God. He said, you're going to say that day, many will say that day, Lord, I cast out the devils in your name, and I healed the sick in your name, and I did this in your name, and I did that in your name. He's going to say, that's great, but I didn't know you. I did not know you. I didn't go intimate with you. All over this building, we're getting ready to repent. I know there's some people already thinking about ways they can duck out, and that's fine. Pastor's not going to think any less of you as a human. You better be concerned about what God thinks of you, not what I think of you. Will you stand, please? Hallelujah. Sister VanLue, Sister Michelle VanLue, if you can come here, please. Amen. I know you're going through it tonight, but amen. These are two beautiful women, and they both mean the world in my life. Amen. Come on, Mama. To this day, I can go into the room of either one of these women, and I can know if they have a problem. Now, I haven't lived in her house for almost 15 years. Hallelujah. But I can walk into the room and look one look at her face, and I know she's upset, or she's mad, or she's crying, or there's something wrong with her. And the same thing with her. I can look at her, one look at her, and say, there is something wrong with my wife. Now, why? Because I know them. I have a relationship with them. Now, so just tell her, if I'm lying, please say I'm lying, because I don't want to be up here lying in the Holy Ghost. But when she used to lead the service, she might not have known what was going on, but the moment she stepped into this pulpit and she turned around, and she'd been in prayer, and she turned around and she looked out, she knew what the Spirit was doing. How? Hopefully that ain't a foreign feeling to her now. How does she know that? Because the Spirit beareth witness. We used to sing this song, "The Jesus in Me Loves the Jesus in You," right? Hallelujah. That's why when you don't love your pastor, there might be a devil in you. That was a joke. I know them because I have a relationship with them. I'm gonna belabor the point, so I'm gonna shut up right now. But Brother Shane Coffey was talking to me about the anointing today, and he said the difference in playing a saxophone when the anointing's not there and when the anointing is there is insane to me, Pastor. He said, I can play a saxophone and I'm not that great. But he said, the Holy Ghost hits me, the anointing hits me. It's like I go to another level. He said, I might not be great, but man, it sounds great to me, you know, because God's being glorified and he's anointing me. And I remember there's things that I'd do on the drums in the middle of anointed service that if I tried to do it again in practice, I couldn't even think about it. Why? Because the Holy Ghost can take you to a level that you've never been before, and you can identify it. Whenever you felt it, you can identify it. So what I'm saying tonight is this: you know full well whether or not you know God like you used to. While I'm preaching to you, you're either being convicted or you're going, amen, hallelujah. I want to know him even more than I know him now. But if you're being convicted, it's because you're not where you could be in God. And we've all been there. And some of us have been there even recently. We just get to a place where we're dry as a shuck and we don't even know how to get out of it. It's like we're in a place where we don't even feel the Lord at all. And I'm telling you right now, if we will repent of our sins tonight, I believe with all my heart there's a spirit of deliverance going to come in this room, and we're going to know God on a level like we used to know him. He's going to restore some people in this room, and then we're going to take it from this point and we're going to get to know him greater every single day. You don't have to pray for hours, but you better talk to him. You don't have to pray for 4 hours, but you better speak at least to him. Just tell him something. All over this house, all over this house, I'm asking everybody to lift your hands as your pastor and begin to talk to God. Let him rip some stuff out of you. Let him pull some stuff out of you. Come on, let a spirit of repentance come over us. Come on, let a cry of repentance go out of our lips. Be real with God. Come on, be real with God right now. God, I want to know you on a level I've never known you before. I want to hear you on a level I've never heard you before. I want to see you on a level I've never seen you before. Because we're at a place as a church where we either have the goods or we don't have the goods. Where we either are real or we're not real. Whether we've got to either be apostolic Pentecostal or we got to stop calling ourselves apostolic Pentecostal. So God, forgive me of every ounce of flesh that gets in your way. Forgive me for every ounce of pride and arrogance that gets in your way. Forgive me for every ounce of time that is not spent by stewardship right, and I get in your way.
Hallelujah. Come on, it's time, men, to turn off some sports radio, turn off politics for a second, and spend some hours in prayer while we're driving to and from work. Come on, men, it's time. It's time to be the priest that God's called us to be. We don't have to know all the stuff about the election if we don't know anything about what Jesus is saying. Come on, put him first. Seek him first. Let's get all those mistletoe junk off of us. All them parasitic vines off of us. Brother Adams, Matt Adams, and Brother Shane Coffee, and Brother Travis LaFoon, and Brother Jonathan Coffee. And they will help me out tonight. And praise God. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. If you do not want to do this, let it pass you by. Bishop is going to administer, amen, this in just a second. And this is going to be our altar. I know what time it is. We won't take a bunch of your time tonight. I will be mindful. But I want us to be real here tonight. Paul said, don't drink this unworthily, not the cup of Christ. So we're going to ask you just to, if you don't want to take it, it's not going to be offensive. Let it pass you by. Bishop's going to administer it. Nobody's going to look around. Nobody's going to be judgmental. We're all one body here. Well, that went over like a lead balloon. We're all one body. But while they're doing this tonight, just bring it on out here, brother. While they're doing this tonight, amen. Brother Morgan, if you want to come, I don't know. I can't tell if you have a work uniform on. My eyes are getting bad. So you can come up here if you don't, if you're not embarrassed by it. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. I think that'll do it. Listen, I want to say this. 1 year, our apple tree that used to be out here where our parking lot is didn't grow. And Jim York came in and he said, I want you to work with me this summer. And him and Brother Bob Cornwell took me out. And Brother Bob Cornwell said, I want to talk to you about something, Jeremy. It's called suckers. I said, man, I love suckers. Hallelujah. I was very young. And he said, no, I want to tell you what suckers are. Suckers are things that attach themselves to the bottom of trees. And that before they can get up to the top, they already suck all the nutrients. And he said, you got to get them things off the tree if you want the fruit to live. And the apple tree didn't really bear that year. But that after those suckers was cut off their bishop, the next year, they bared a little bit more. And the next year, they bared a little bit more. That apple tree began to bear fruit again where it was stopped. It didn't bear forever. And then all of a sudden, it just starts bearing fruit again because it got all that stuff off of it that was pulling at the nutrients of it. And that's what we're going to have to do. Get rid of all the junk and allow God to speak through us. Amen. Bible talks about this being the cup of Christ, and this is not to be taken lightly. It's very serious. Also, I urge you, if you don't have the Holy Ghost, please don't take it. Amen. Hallelujah, because this is something that's serious and sincere. And Bishop's going to come out here. He's going to minister it, and he's going to bless it. If we don't have enough gentlemen, we have more in the back here. We can do real quick. Amen. He's going to minister it. He's going to bless it. He's going to allow us to do this. He's going to walk us through it. We got to know him. Now, if you just repented, that's enough. But you better be sincere when you repent. Hallelujah. Don't be fake with the Lord. Amen. And I want us to sing a song together if we can. And I know it's an old song, and I know it's something we sing every communion, but I think it needs to be sang tonight. And allow God to do this. We're going to try to hit the right key without Sister Adams. Amen. The blood that Jesus shed for me way back on Calvary. It's the blood that gives me strength from day to day. It will never, never, never lose its power. Sing this with us if you know it. For it reaches to the highest mountain, and it flows to the lowest valley. Oh, the blood that gives me strength from day to day, it will never, never, never lose its power. Come on, Bishop. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Eshamakatara la mahasaya. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. La moya tia ramatasa. Pastor preached to us a tremendous message. Do you know him? We're getting ready to take communion. I wrote something down here that communion is an intimate relationship with deep understanding. An intimate relationship with deep understanding. The act of sharing one's thoughts and emotions. Do you know him? Do you know him intimately? If you know someone intimately, you know the innermost part about them. And there's nothing hid from the person that you have the relationship with. I'm going to say just something, and I don't want to do any more or less than what Pastor asked me to do. He preached my heartbeat tonight because I am really concerned about you knowing him. My wife and I came out of a church. It was a good church, worshiping church, and my pastor was an outstanding preacher. But when my wife and I got saved, we had no teaching whatsoever of holiness. But when she got the Holy Ghost, nobody had to preach to her about how to dress. Nobody had to tell her anything about you don't wear slacks and shorts no more. Because she got the Holy Ghost. I believe when our pastor preached tonight, when you get the Holy Ghost
that just some things the Holy Ghost teaches you that you don't have to have somebody tell you what to do. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23 said, "For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do ye in remembrance of me." The bread. Ikemoyatosha. The body was broken for you. This do ye in remembrance of me. Mayote barite que mayando sataya. Hey, carayandi barrea masa. In Jesus' name. After the same manner, also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me." The cup. Mera ushamo kamarita. Hey, ulo bayo mo koriya mata. Andorra me come yato sita moya. Coleremo te aramacasaya. If you would allow me to read one more verse. For as often, everybody say often, as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he come. For as often as you remain intimate with him, as often as you remain intimate with your relationship with deep understanding, and you remain in that vein that you know him. Would you raise your hands and intimately tell him you love him right now? Hey!
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Jesus. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. All right, let's lift our hands and love the Lord. Yield to the Spirit. Somebody. Yield to the Spirit. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. All right, this is what we're going to do. I feel like the Lord just showed me this. We're going to get some of our ducks in a row. And I'm going to ask if you're a priest of your house. That means if you're a single mother. That means if you're a father or a dad, you're the priest of your home. We're going to get some of our ducks in a row here. I got to get some stuff together. We're going to give some of these out. And we're going to minister these in our homes. And when we do, we're going to do it like the Passover. And I'll walk you through that at a later date. But we're going to go through our house and we're going to paint the blood of Jesus on every door. I don't care if you have an unsaved spouse. We're going to paint the blood of Jesus on every door. And we're going to make sure all the sin is out of our home. Now the sin today is not leaven. Well, that went, I said the sin today is not leaven, but it is still just as dangerous because I feel like God is getting ready to separate his church. I'm not just talking about rapture. I feel like he's getting ready to show the world who the church is and who the imposters have been. We're going to do this in our homes as well, and we're going to do it the fourth week of every month. We're going to wake it every month. So next November, right after Thanksgiving, we'll do it. Does that make sense? Amen. That's what I feel like the Lord showed me. Amen. You're dismissed tonight. If you have cups, please bring them to the front. Amen. The ministers will be standing up here, and I will help you get them into the trays. Please do not take the cups home because they are real.